What will you do that for?
You look sad.
Right. Oh, that's a waste.
Right, okay, I don't think this is helping, guys.
My name is Jonny. I shall be your host for today.
Hello, first of all. My name is Mandeep Dhillon.
My name's Tom. I'm an actor and writer and stand-up comedian as well.
Hi, I'm Claire and I work for Marie Curie.
My name's Simon Gunning. I'm CEO of Calm.
I suppose the thing that I come back to with Afterlife and also people talk to me about the most whenever I meet anyone who wants to talk about the show, which is quite often with this show compared to other stuff I've been in, it's something that people really do want to talk about, is the fact that Ricky's character, Tony, doesn't get better. And I think this is something we're very used to in narratives, is at the point at which the hero conquers their demons. And what is, I think, so powerful about this show and resonates with so many people is the fact that Tony doesn't. He's got to live with it. It feels very truthful to me, and a lot of the people I've spoken to have really wanted to talk about that element of it and how important that has been for them as a message.
Drinking isn't my illness, is it?
Well, no, but it's bad for you.
Everything's bad for you. We're all dying. Being healthy is just dying more slowly, so...
Okay, so you'll live longer.
Yeah, but why?
What do you mean, why? So you can do more of the things that you enjoy?
I enjoy a drink.
Right.
As Tony's character develops, it becomes clear that it's okay to be miserable. It's a very normal and human response to bereavement and to quite often life in general. What's not okay is living miserably, is living with long-term misery. That's what drives people into a state of hopelessness. Humans are complex things, and I really liked the way that the Tony character was likable one minute and repellent the next, because most of us are in many ways, but the grief defined him and was like almost like you know, pulling the strings on his behavior. I thought was fascinating.
Fuck that,
please,
that's ridiculous. Wind chimes, slurping, sniffing. How is that relaxing? It's disgusting.
See you next Tuesday.
You're not wrong there, you fucking snot-curdling cunt.
Okay,
I think the main thing that I took from Afterlife was that it's okay not to be okay. Yeah, I think that's it. And that's definitely something that I am learning in my own personal life as well.
It was also kind of a
systemic way of looking at grief as well, because Tom, your character was also grieving, and it just showed the different ways that people grieve, the different, what it's like to lose a partner, how you lose all of the rhythms of your life, you lose everything that you would normally be doing, you have to recreate. But other people are around you when you're grieving, and yeah, losing a sister is important at the same time as losing a marriage. Your character as well, she was so sad but just got on with it. So there was a lot of balance in it, really.
Well, I think it shows what it's like for everyone around the person who's grieving as well, which is really important. The fact that we don't really know how to behave around Tony. We're torn between trying to intervene and leaving him alone, and sort of, you know, Mandeep's character, Sandy, saying, like, just please be happy, stuff that sort of, it feels, you know, just so futile trying to help people in that position.
The moments where he was sort of feeling suicidal, I see that quite a lot with people who, it's tiring being without the person that you want to be with, and sometimes it will be nice to just go to sleep and not wake up, and I think that's what I hear an awful lot as well. Not that I intend to kill myself, but just it would be so nice if I could just go to sleep and not wake up. And Tony, he was going through that, but in a kind of a different way, and that's really refreshing that he could just have that.
You can get addicted to it. I am, I think. Grief, I mean. I sort of know where I am with it. Do you know what I mean? When something goes well or I see a glimpse of hope, I get confused. And then when it all turns to shit, I go, oh, there it is. Now we can get drunk and wait for death.
Mandeep, just wanted to come to you. When you first got the script for Afterlife, what was your kind of reaction? I mean,
it was refreshing to read something that's so real and not sugar-coated and not afraid to be ugly and truthful, and you know, all the pain is there. I think that was one thing that I was like, that's great, because that's how it is. What about you, Tom?
Initially, I didn't really quite understand how it was going to work. When I first learned about the show, Ricky called me and sort of described the idea. And it was like, so it's about a guy who's lost his wife and he's grieving. And I suppose my reaction was, right, but then what happens? Like, can it just be that? And he was like, no, it is that. That's what it is. And it's about that situation. Now, I think in most comedy, in most drama, the shows are built around characters who want things, who are out in the world trying to achieve things. And with grief, you don't really know what you want. You know, people don't really... They want something that's impossible. They want someone back, and so therefore, it's so rare to try and turn it into comedy or drama, anyway. But when you do, I think it's even braver to try and tell the story that Ricky's doing, which is about exactly that—the fact that he just wants something that he can't have.
You look sad.
Good work.
So how can comedy help us to really kind of access those really tough, complex, taboo subjects like suicide?
It's a very difficult question. I don't really know, Jonny, but what I would say is, like, the thing that seems to help Tony so much in the show is his sense of humour, and that no matter what happens, he doesn't lose that. And in a way, I think that the fact he can still laugh at things and at people and lose himself in funny conversations demonstrates that there's hope for him, and demonstrates that there's a side of his personality that is still very much alive and engaging with other people. And I sort of think, if you know, if there is one thing that is keeping him going, it's his ability to find things funny.
Do your horoscope for you if you like.
Nah, because it's pointless.
They make it vague so you can make it fit. I want to see one in the paper that says, "Happy birthday, Rita Wainthrop of 7 Acacia Drive, Wigan. You're going to get fired from your job today because everyone hates you and the boss thinks you're a slut." Then I'd believe it.
You always have to get silly, don't you?
Without that, we try to tend to sort of be reductionist, don't we, and try to say that, for example, with that character, in most culture, he would be reduced just to being that. Rather than, as we know, humans continue to be multifaceted. We found with Calm, anyway, that comedy as a route into difficult subjects, if not conversations, but is a great way of just kicking the doors in.
His dad said it's either him or me. One of us has got to go for this to work.
And you chose him?
Oh, no, I chose his dad at first, but when we asked James to leave, he broke down, threatened to kill himself, didn't you?
Yeah. It's disarming. And it also means that what we're not doing is kind of trying to hold somebody's hand and say, come to this really scary, dark place where we're going to talk about a really scary thing. What we do is you just start to integrate it into the way that our brains are working already, that we are going to laugh at things, we are going to get sad at things, because that's how brains work. But to avoid that reductionism and to avoid subjects like happiness, sadness and suicide becoming taboo subjects that live in this little sort of emotional ghetto, I think is a really great thing that Afterlife has done.
Kath just asked me to sit next to her at the cabaret thing.
Great.
I need to get out of it.
Why?
Please help me get out of it, please.
How?
Say you're thinking of killing yourself again.
Say I'm thinking of killing myself next Thursday.
Well, I'll tell her then.
You'll tell her you can't go with her because I'm thinking of killing myself.
Have you seen, in your conversations with people since Afterlife was broadcast, have you seen people referring to Afterlife and the kind of the power of its, the comedy and the show that have helped them in terms of their own journeys? Has that been something that either Claire or Simon, you've come across, people referencing Afterlife?
The people that we work with, it's a both and, not an either or. They still have their sense of humour. They still carry on living. People who are grieving when they've lost somebody, they still carry on with their sense of humour and they still carry on living.
And I think actually, Claire, you hit on it really well, which is that what we need to do, not just Calm, but all of us around us, and we talk a lot about behaviour change and looking after our mates and looking after our families and the people around us, is to not kind of view mental health as some sort of dramatic, explosive or plosive moment, you know, that it's that life is hopefully long and with it there are many peaks and many troughs, and Tony's suicidality is not one of, you know, explosions and you know, big flashes and bangs. It's one of long pervasive misery, and I think that's the, so we've seen that reflected on our helpline, people talking about it after the episodes are dropped, and also definitely amongst sort of colleagues and people that we work with, it's definitely made a cultural impact.
And Mandeep and Tom, I mean, what's the reaction been from kind of your family, your friends? I mean, has it opened up any conversations with, you know, people around you?
Yeah, I mean, I have, there's been a few people close to me who have mental health and who have unfortunately experienced psychotic episodes, which I've seen firsthand. So actually in my household and amongst my friends, it's a topic that's very much always spoken about. It's very much part of my life, really. So, which is great. And I'm so grateful that it is, because it's so important. And it's so normal.
Absolutely. I think the thing as well that I loved about Afterlife was, because you mentioned the word normal, Mandeep. And the thing about Afterlife, it just shows there is no normal. I mean, you think of all the different people that, you know, Ricky's character goes and interviews for the paper. I mean, it's amazing. The kind of, the variety of people.
It's a load of bollocks.
I'm trans. Deal with it.
You're not trans, you're having a breakdown.
Transphobic.
When did you first discover you could speak to cats?
How long have you been posting your mail in a dog waste bin?
About a year and I would say.
I think in the paper and the characters, everybody just wants to be seen. I love, you know, Daphne wants to be seen. As her and Pat, everybody wants to be seen. And I just think, yeah, just like them. We all want our story in the paper sometimes. We want to sit on that bench and listen to us. We want to be seen. We want to be heard. And they're, yeah.
Smile.
Bollocks.
And I guess this is a bit of a nosy question, so I hope you don't mind me asking. Because of the subject that was being filmed, do you think there was a difference offset as well in terms of, like, you being more, yeah, open and honest and frank with each other than maybe you would if it wasn't about, you know, mental health, grief? Does that make sense?
I mean, it's hard with Ricky because he's so Ricky, isn't he, Tom? That doesn't even make sense, but he's very much silly when he wants to be.
Yeah, I mean, we'll be sort of cracking up about something really stupid and irrelevant on set, and then we'll have to go into a scene that's really intense and about very kind of serious emotions. And it is quite a disorientating thing at times, making the show. But then that's what the show does to the viewer as well. You know, you go from laugh out loud moments to suddenly really kind of pit, you know, dark pits of grief, and you sort of flip between those things, as Simon was saying, like everyone does in their life. And it's a very particular process making the show. I mean, it's a huge amount of fun, but it is emotionally, you do find yourself being thrown about quite a bit.
You're laughing. Crying.
Oh, they fuck my tear ducts.
You right?
Huh? Yeah.
Just feeling a bit low.
Come on, mate, you were doing so well.
Just feeling sorry for myself and guilty about that. I meet people every day with worse lives than me, and they get on with it. And I try and be more zen. I'm not going to let cunts wind me up.
Is that a Buddha quote?
Exactly.
Well, we know that men are 63% less likely to go and talk to a GP about anything, let alone anything to do with emotions and embarrassing stuff. So that's just a part of long-term socialization, isn't it? With this strange confusion between stoicism and strength, when we know that the opposite is absolutely true. We know that it's hard to talk about this stuff.
People think that all those things I miss doing with Lisa, I could just do them anyway, and that'll make me feel better. But they're missing the point. I don't miss doing things with Lisa. I miss doing nothing with Lisa.
Yeah, as far as Calm is concerned, we work with high risk groups. We want to help high risk people at high risk, and unfortunately, half the population are three times more risk of suicide by dint of their gender.
It's kind of socially accepted that we are emotional, whereas men feel exactly the same. They feel exactly the same, and you know, I've got close guys to me who bottle it all up so much that it does end up in a breakdown, and it's so hard to see. But then shows like this come along and you're like, great, like that's, it's okay, you know. I think it's really good that Ricky's character is just emotional, real, out there, and not afraid of that. And I can't wait till guys can experience that all over as well.
I think, Jonny, that there's a really important thing that we bang on about a great deal because it's so powerful. So one thing at the end of one end of the spectrum, we know that suicide is contagious, that once the people are directly affected by suicide, they become straight away much more likely to at least attempt suicide themselves. And that's based largely on it becoming an option, right? So it can become something which is far more reasonable to consider than if you haven't been affected. At the other end of the scale, though, is a thing called the Papageno effect, which is it's a little puppet in the magic flute. And that there are so many studies that show that hope is at least as contagious as despair. And that showing stories of survival, especially from suicide, that of getting to the point of that not only being an option, but being an actionable one, but then not doing it. And then being able to look at the positives of not having done it.
And today, we find out that the owner of the paper is selling up and we'll all lose our jobs.
Oh, no.
No, that's not the bad bit. I was fine with that. But then Sandy starts crying because it's the only job she's ever liked. And so I've got to try and save the paper for her sake. And my brother-in-law, who was sleeping on the floor of the office, is now sleeping at Lenny's council house because Lenny's shacked up with June, who persuaded him to give her fat kid a job at the paper. Just think, if I'd have killed myself, I'd have missed all this.
And Claire, I mean, do you find there's a difference in terms of, you know, the people you're working with, in terms of gender, you know, how open they are, how vulnerable they are, how likely they are to actually access support in the first place? Do you think there's a difference in the genders?
Yeah, over like more than a decade that I've been doing this, I think that women are definitely more willing to do the talking, to come. And with men, there can be a lot of shame around, I need someone to talk to, I can't do this for myself. I was struck by what, when Tony was looking at when to start up a relationship, and I think that's that can be a big part of what men bring to the table when they want to know, is it okay to move on with my life? Is it okay to have a relationship? And I thought it was really brave in Afterlife that he said no.
So.
I see you every day. It's lovely. I get a lovely feeling. Why can't it just carry on like that? And then we die.
Yeah. Groundhog Day.
It might not always be like that. I'm better than I was. Maybe one day I won't feel like I'm being unfaithful to my wife, but I just can't. I can't promise. You know, I love this, but it can't be anymore. You know?
So there's a definite difference, but hopefully we're talking more about death and dying. We're talking more about, you know, grief. So it will be easier for people to talk going forward. And this helps enormously.
And I guess just to, because we're running out of time, just Mandeep and Tom, just to finish off, I mean, kind of looking towards the future, and I guess, you know, future portrayals of you know, mental illness, of grief, of suicide on screen, would you like to see more of these kind of characters like Ricky's, you know, more comedy, drama?
Well, I think there's definitely an appetite for it, you know. I think, like, one of the things I've been struck by in terms of feedback that I got from people is that people are really, like, genuinely love the show. They found it really enjoyable, that people haven't been depressed by it. They haven't found it heavy or hard going. They found it really engaging and really funny. And I think that shows you that there's a thirst for these conversations. It's not something that people feel afraid of anymore, or that they think it's right that we just kind of bury our head in the sand. They want to see it. And I think that's really good.
I realize that death will come soon enough, so, and there's nothing to fear about it, because, you know, no feelings to worry about, not mine anyway, just, you know, peace and quiet. I am trying to work out if there's a way I can still carry on annoying people after I die, but I haven't cracked it yet, so I'm just gonna have to make the most of that when I'm alive.
So if anyone has been watching this and, you know, they've been affected by anything that's been said, please do know that there's so much support out there. The therapist that we saw in Afterlife is, I think it's hopefully very rare that you'll be met
very
with that.
Rare.
I think it's very rare that you'll be met with any sort of, and if you are met with that, please tell us and
we'll
sort them out.
Don't worry about it.
He's the most appalling therapist that there's ever been, and absolutely brilliant.
Do you know what I loved about Afterlife, or one of the particular characters I loved the most was Anne in Afterlife. The way that she listened, and the gentle kind of, well, the gentleness and the kindness and the wisdom that she gave. And there are so many millions of Annes out there if you need help and support.
That's what.
So
you.
Absolutely.
That is what therapy is.
That's what therapy is, Anne's character. So if you want therapy,
yeah,
that's what you're going to get, that kind of vibe and that help.
When Lisa was dying, I tried to be brave and put a, you know, a face on to be positive. And even then, I'd break down sometimes and she'd have to comfort me. I couldn't even give her that. When she was dying, she was still on duty, looking after me.
She'd have loved that.
I don't know.
I do. Because I'm a woman too. And it's better to be needed.
You know, she doesn't sit there lecturing Ricky's character, does she? She just, that listening and that wisdom is out there in so many of your volunteers, and so I just want people to know that, yeah, there is plenty of help and support available through different organizations and through different mediums as well. So, you know, whether that be picking up the phone or sending a text or actually seeing someone in person, there's so many people out there to listen to you when you need it. So please do remember that if you've been watching this and been affected by anything at all.
Great. Thanks for your help. Have you got any therapist friends you could talk to?